无限量，香港艺术节，香港赛马会慈善信托基金联合主办，香港展能艺术会为策略支持伙伴，赛马会无限量教育及社区外展节目。
Hello， 大家好，我是 Tisa 何家坤，我今日系着住一件高领黑白花嘅衫，同埋我一头系白发嚟嘅，同埋短嘅白头发。咁喺呢度今日就好高兴，代表香港艺术节欢迎大家嚟到今日呢个无限量嘅网上圆桌讨论，踏入第四年啦。我哋今年3月1日开始咧，就已经喺网上有一连串嘅精彩节目，由海外同埋本地嘅唔同能力嘅艺术家嘅作品。等到大家可以足不出户免費收睇嘅。咁今日呢個圓桌討論咧，就係賽馬會無限量教育及社區外展節目嘅重點嘅一環。三年嚟，我哋都討論點樣去補及共融藝術。咁今日咧就好高興有幾位海外嘅專家啦，同埋香港嘅資深專家同埋嘉賓，在這裡分享他們的實踐經驗和討論這個話題。在這裡我一定要衷心多謝香港賽馬會慈善信託基金對無限量的支持，和我們一起共同 做這件事。同時我也借這個機會多謝這個我們的夥伴香港展能藝術會提供的通達服務啦，同埋一眾無限量嘅支持機構團隊朋友，同埋今日每一位參與呢個活動嘅朋友，希望一陣間嘅討論咧會啟發大家進一步對香港社會共融藝術嘅發展。
大家好。歡迎大家觀賞2022年度的無限量節目。藝術無疆界，每一個人都應該享有創作和欣賞藝術的平等機會。因此在2019年開始，馬會和香港藝術節聯合主辦了無限量計劃，為本地和國際不同能力的演藝精英提供了盡展才華的舞台，同時也讓市民無障礙地去體驗藝術的樂趣。今屆活動將一如既往，透過音樂、舞蹈、戲劇和電影等等豐富的節目，配合多元化的賽馬會、無限量教育及社區外展節目，為觀眾啟發新的視野，同時也提升演藝工作者的專業能力和自信心，更加促進本地共融藝術的持續發展，也藉此增加不同能力人士和公眾的互相了解，推動社會共融。在疫情的新常態之下，有部分節目是會移師在網上進行，突破時空的界限，充分體現無限量的精神，傳遞無限的正能量。馬會在推動藝術文化和保育方面向來不遺餘力，包括連續50年支持了香港藝術節，持續為香港注入藝術文化活力，推動創意共融。這個反映了馬會秉持致力建設更美好社會的宗旨，用一個獨特的綜合營運模式，透過稅收和慈善捐款，將博彩和彩券的收入回饋給香港。最後，我要感謝特區政府、香港藝術節協會和香港展能藝術會對這個計劃的支持。我祝願今年的無限量圓滿成功，各位表演者在藝壇上繼續發光發亮，鼓舞人心。多謝大家。
Hello everyone, welcome to the 2022 No Limits online roundtable discussion, co-presented by the Hong Kong Arts Festival and the Hong Kong Jockey Club Charities Trust. This year's topic is sustainable practices in nurturing disability arts. I'm Austin Yip, the moderator for today's roundtable discussion. I have short black hair, I'm wearing a blue coat as well as a white shirt. I'm also a composer. Today, we will have 6 outstanding overseas and local artists, educators, and experts from the field to share with us their experiences and knowledge in discovering and cultivating arts for people with different abilities, while exploring effective methods and directions for future sustainable practices. Our discussion will be divided into two parts. Part one will be conducted in English. There will be three keynote presentations, followed by a short Q&A section after each of them. On the top left corner of your screen, you can see three channels, and you may choose your preferred language there. On the right-hand side of the screen, you can see the Hong Kong Sign Language interpretation, and on the bottom left, we will have the English live captioning. You can open the Chinese live captioning in a separate window by selecting the icon under the language bar. If you have any questions or comments to the speakers, please post in the Q&A column on the screen, and I will read your questions later. Before continuing to the panel discussion in part two, we will take a 5-minute break. The second part will be conducted in both English and Cantonese. Our first speaker is Anthony Evans from the United Kingdom. Evans is the co-director of the international inclusive art nonprofit organization Epic Arts, based in Cambodia, where he has developed specialist knowledge in the engagement and employment of people with disabilities in the arts in Asia. We are honored to have Anthony Evans here to share on the topic, arts and disability within a Cambodian context. Anthony, please.
Hello, everybody. Absolutely delighted to be with you. And I'm talking to you from Birmingham, England. I'm a male with glasses. I've got a grey blue check shirt on and I have curly hair. So just to give you a bit of a background about me, my name is Anthony Evans. I'm co-director of Epic Arts Cambodia. I've been director at Epic Arts since 2013, so quite some time now. I've spent 4 years in Cambodia on the ground in Kampot before moving back to the UK with my family. And like I say, today I'm speaking to you from Birmingham. As you can see on the map that is in front of you, Kampot is on the very south coast of Cambodia, almost on the border with Vietnam. Next slide, please. So it's really important for me to give you a little bit of context around the sort of disability arts, a bit of background to provide that context. So I'm going to start with a little bit about Cambodia's history. So year zero was the dawn of a new age where there would be no families, no sentiment, no expression of love or grief, no medicine, no hospitals, no schools, no books, no learning, no holidays, no music, no song, no post, no money, only work and death. Basically, Cambodia had a horrific genocide in the 1970s. That was led by Pol Pot. And you can see Pol Pot's image in the bottom right of this picture. During the Khmer Rouge regime that Pol Pot led, many people were killed. If you were a teacher, if you were a doctor, if you were an artist, you were killed. Many people disappeared during that time. Artists disappeared, singers, songwriters, musicians, the Royal Ballet. Many, many artists were killed during the Pol Pot regime. But it's estimated that sort of around 2.2 million people died in 4 years. And there is also a picture of the killing fields on that image where many of the people were actually put to death. 90% of all the artists disappeared and along with them, all the culture and artistic skill and knowledge, along with the teachers. So a lot of the educational knowledge and doctors. So a lot of medical knowledge was lost as well. Like I say, that gives a really, really important context today to where disability arts in Cambodia is actually now, because it's still very relevant. Next slide, please. So Epic Arts works with a number of people with disabilities. So I'm just going to, again, explain a little bit more about the context. Officially, 15% of the population have a disability. But the figure is actually probably much higher because we're not entirely sure whether people in rural villages are actually registering and the systems aren't in place to actually map and log the actual amount. So we think it's around 15%. There is no government support for people with disabilities. So they find themselves isolated, like I say, particularly in those rural areas. All support is provided by NGOs, so non-government organisations or charities that are working in the country. And many people with disabilities experience economic hardship as they can't work, and many are actually without homes. So they perhaps live with monks in the pagoda or are homeless. Most people, most buildings in Cambodia are actually built on stilts because of the high level of water and the rice paddies. So the buildings are high up in the air, and that means that access to schools, community centres and homes is very difficult for anyone who is in a wheelchair. Next slide, please. So there are a number of factors that contribute to that high prevalence of disability in Cambodia that does relate to the context that I provided before, the Khmer Rouge, and then some other ones as well that I'll just go through now. Poor health and safety. So for example, you can see there the electricity pylons. We see a high level of electricity and building related incidents. Landmines, there are estimated to be one landmine for every person in Cambodia still. And that's from the, that remains from the war with Vietnam in the 60s and 70s, the American war, that many of the unexploded mines are still in a lot of those rural areas in Cambodia. And that still causes problems. We still have a number of people in our programs that are coming that are newly disabled and that those are, that's because they found landmines in fields or rice paddies that detonated. So it's still very, very, very prominent. Poor healthcare. All doctors were killed during the Khmer Rouge regime. So current knowledge is that limited, you know, very limited. Medication is very expensive. Doctors are having, you know, previously had to leave the country to be trained again. So, you know, the medical profession is on its way back, but actually over the last 30 years has had to sort of pick up from nothing. So wrong medication has been given to people. People have had infections and not been treated, and all this has added up to a high level of disability. Next slide, please. So the official religion in Cambodia is Buddhism, and this is relevant because many people see that those with a disability may have done wrong in the past. Obviously, they believe in karma, and there is a sort of a feeling that perhaps disabled people may have done wrong in a previous life, or are bad luck to be with or be around, or may have done something wrong. So that is, you know, just a bit of context around the religion there. People with learning difficulties or mental health issues are seen as people who are cursed or have demons, and are often tied up in villages or, you know, hidden in the house, hidden behind the scenes so that, you know, nobody can see them. There's a lot of shame and a lot of embarrassment around disability. So this is also, again, what we're dealing with, the kind of current context of what we're dealing with. So having provided that, next slide, please. I can tell you a little bit about Epic Arts. So there are my details there and the website and the usual socials. What is Epic Arts doing in Cambodia to discover and support disabled artists? Well, Epic Arts believes that together we can build a society where every person counts. So EPIC, E-P-I-C, EPIC stands for Every Person Counts, which is why our little eye is upside down. Epic Arts is an international inclusive arts organisation based in Cambodia and registered as a charity in the UK. We use the arts as a form of expression and empowerment to bring people with and without disabilities together. We aim to promote the message that every person counts through our inclusive education, community and social enterprise programmes. Next slide, please. And it's today that I'm really going to talk, speaking to the team, the No Limits team. They really wanted me to focus on the social enterprise kind of thing. I think we're getting a lot of examples of work with disabled communities. But what I'm going to focus on is the sort of social enterprise part of our organization. So Epic Arts has three programs: Epic Arts Inclusive Education, Epic Arts Community, and Epic Arts Social Enterprise. And like I say, I'm going to focus on the bottom one, the social enterprise. And that is because, if we can move to the next slide. Our social enterprise program comprises of our income generating businesses. And so the profits from these businesses go into the budget for our education and community work. So we're actually a very good example of an organization that's trying to be self-sufficient. Next slide, please. So the largest of our businesses is the Epic Arts Cafe, and this employs around 10 disabled young people and serves thousands of customers every year. Kampot is a tourist town, and so the majority of these customers are travellers, and we generate some income from a small business also called Epic Creations that sells handicrafts and t-shirts inside the cafe. Up to the point of the pandemic, the cafe provided between 50 and 60% of our budget each year. So it was going a long way to making us self-sustaining. And we now have plans to grow once international travel has settled, and we're seeking partnership investment to scale up the cafe activities. And I actually have a little video to show you about Epic Arts Cafe just here. Next slide, thank you.
Epic Art is an inclusive art charity based in Kampot, Cambodia.
The cafe is a social enterprise and helps to fund the inclusive education of children and young people in Kampot.
Over 60% of the income for Epic Art comes from our social enterprise.
This brand because a lot of our staff have disability.
People like to come to Epic Art Cafe because our environment is friendly and the food is delicious.
We want to expand our business and need your help.
You can support us by donating.
We are always looking for support, and any money you give us will help to expand the business and to keep supporting people with disabilities.
Thank you, Okun.
Thank you, Okun.
So, as we say, between 50 and 60%, depending on the year and the amount of tourists that we have in the country, is what we can put back into our budget. And what that goes back in towards is our other programs, our community or our education programs. Next slide, please. So using the arts to empower people in Cambodia, that's what our programs do. And we do that by working with lots and lots of different people in the community. So next slide, please. Teaching and developing skills of artists is a big thing. Teaching transferable skills through the arts, developing confidence and self-belief, valuing people with disabilities by valuing their creativity and their ideas. And we do that through our education programs based at our center in Kampot. So we create leaders with disabilities. We train teachers with disabilities, and overall we act in our community as a sort of beacon of inclusive working and an example of inclusive working. Next slide, please. We advocate and support disabled teachers in schools, and we hold public showcases in the community. Like I say, we really try to put disabled people at the front of everything that we do. Next slide, please. Using the arts to transform attitudes in Cambodia. Next slide. One of the aspects of our work is our enterprise work is our dance company. We have Epic Encounters Performance Company, who are a performance company that do dance shows in Cambodia and internationally. Their repertoire is a mix of educational theatre and original choreography, created with some of the best and innovative choreographers from around the world. Next slide, please. This changes attitudes in Cambodia because we perform all around Cambodia. Performers comment on disability, they give educational performances, and we create film-based campaigns about issues in Cambodia, such as road safety. Next slide, please. We also tour to other places. We often deliver paid workshops for participants in other countries that we visit. And Epic Encounters have performed in Japan, Australia, India, and Singapore. Next slide, please. Our latest performance in the Epic Encounters repertoire is Buffalo Boy, which I think some of you may have seen as part of this festival. Buffalo Boy was developed in the UK the year before the pandemic and is ready for international touring now. And that also comes with a wraparound workshop. Next slide, please. We also have a tourist show called Come Back Brighter, and there's a little video about that here.
In 1965, my country was just like yours. Khmer people were full of hope and the future looked bright. A word they would not know for very long. No family, no hospital, no school, no book, no learning, no music, no expression of love, only work and death. The dawn of a new age, year zero.
So that's an example of our tourist show that's also an income generator in our local town where our dancers perform. So what you're looking at now is a little pie chart that explains the percentage of our income from our social enterprises and how that breaks down. And as you can see, the majority of that is our cafe and our dance company. So moving to the end of the presentation now, I wanted to include a video, another video, but I don't think we're going to have time to do that. But the team assure me that they will send our Shake It Off video around to the delegates. It's a great video that we use for marketing Epic Arts and just really shouting about the work that we do and keeping us in people's minds. And then finally, just to end, I just want to talk a little bit about Epic Arts Manifesto. We have a 12-point manifesto. That is basically appreciation, we value each other, determination, we have a can-do attitude, we value possibility, seeing ability in others, uniqueness, and we have inclusive actions that we practice, patience, integrity, equality and creativity, and our inclusive personal skills that we implement at Epic Arts, communication, togetherness, quality and adaptability, and that's what we find is the most important when working with our team. Thank you very much. Next slide, please. You can contact me if you have any questions around anything that I've said today. Please contact me on the details there. And as I said before, we're available on all the usual channels, the social channels. So thank you for having me. I look forward to taking part in the rest of the conversations.
Thank you, Anthony, for sharing your experience and expertise. We will now open the floor for questions. Please feel free to share your questions or comment on the chat room. And I see one question now. The question for you, Anthony, is how do you train them or help them to adapt in the workplace?
So as you saw there, I talked a bit about social enterprise, but we actually have our education program, and that is a 2-year education program called the Inclusive Arts Course. So participants come from all around Cambodia to take part in the Inclusive Arts Course, and they have modules in dance and performance. They also have modules in visual art. They have modules in computers, English, Khmer language, reading and writing, and we also have training in creating CVs and how to interview. So we sort of have quite a round course there that is very arts focused, but actually also has some sort of other skills, hard skills that the participants learn.
Now, in terms of the skills and the courses that you're offering, do they get to choose whatever they want to do, or is there like some kind of like placement test that you're giving them before enrolling?
Yes. So initially, and it has evolved over the last sort of 20 years from the first vocational training program, as it was called very, very early on. What we have to be realistic about is that there isn't lots and lots of jobs for dancers, and there's not lots and lots of jobs for artists in Cambodia. So what we try to do is the initial part of the course is a real taster, a real light touch, just aiming to inspire and really build confidence amongst some of these young people who may have been, who've never experienced anything like it before, probably never had the opportunity to set foot outside their house or village. So a lot of it is very, you know, a taster-based course at the beginning. And then as they work out a little bit about Epic Arts and what they like doing, whether that be, you know, serving in the cafe or whether it be dancing in the dance company, they then start to get a taste and a feel for it. And then that's the second year they tend to specialize in the area that they enjoy.
Right. Thank you so much. Now, we'll save the remaining questions for the Q&A section at the end. And we would now like to move on to the second speaker first. Thank you so much, Anthony. Our second speaker is Dr. John Vaughan. Dr. Vaughan is an American pianist who lives in Taipei, a full-time professor of piano at Suzhou University. He is also a performer, lecturer, and writer whose activities span the divide between academia and popular entertainment. We are honored to have Dr. Vaughan here to share on the topic, Can You See What I Hear? The personal story of nurturing a visually impaired musician in Taiwan. 聲聲不息一個台灣視像音樂家的育成故事 Dr. Vaughan, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm John Vaughan. I'm wearing black, I have glasses, and I'm the one juggling balls. Okay, that's me. Nice to be here today. I'm looking forward to sharing my story with a student with special abilities. I'm not an expert in special education or that kind of thing, but I have experience. I've taught 3 blind piano students, and I've spent almost 25 years with one very special student, which is the story that I'll share with everyone today. Please change the slide. I've been living in Taiwan for now 28 years, and my experience with this one student has been incredible. It's not only led to almost continuous discoveries and eye-opening experiences, but it's also changed my life in a very big way. Please change the slide. My relationship with this blind student, his name is Xu Zhecheng, it can be broken up into 3 periods. The first period begins in 1998. At that time, I had already lived in Taipei for 5 years, and I was teaching music at a university. And one day I received a phone call from this student's teacher. And the teacher asked me if I would listen to the student and if I could take him on as a student. So I invited him to come over and play for me. And at the time, he was 11 years old. So he was in elementary school, 5th grade in the system here. And at the time, he was quite advanced. He played a Chopin Fantasy Impromptu. Quite a difficult piece for such a young child. And I was very impressed. His technique was quite good, but what really attracted me was the sound he could create out of a piano. It was very refined, and it's rare that you hear a child that that can use those kind of sounds and produce that kind of sound. And so I was excited to work with him. So I accepted him. I told him that we would try lessons for a month and see how it went. Frankly, I wasn't sure I was the right teacher for this student. So I wanted to give us a little period that we could just see if we were comfortable with each other. And after about a month, it was very easy to see that we got along well together. And I was incredibly excited to teach this student. There were all kinds of challenges that I was forced to confront. And his piano lessons were sponsored by a local temple. And they had requested that due to his special talent and his situation that our lessons would be a minimum of 2 hours. And it turned out that they were. They often became 3 hours, and class was often, we rarely looked at the time. It was often we were having so much fun that time would go by, and the next thing we know it, his family was there to come pick him up from my house. Please change the slide. In the lesson, I was forced to become creative in my teaching. In piano, with most of my students, I sit at one piano and the student sits at another. So there is a lot of demonstrating going on. Demonstrating things about sound were easier than any student I've had. Almost anything I could play, he could imitate. And not only the notes could he play back, the expression and many aspects were very easy. But in our visual world, the world that we most of us live in, I would often demonstrate about how to use your hand, the position, how to use your arm weight, how flexible to make your wrist. And all of these kind of suggestions, I would have to change my way of teaching. And often it just became that what I used to just talk about, I would have to use the sense of touch. Often I would put my arm on top or on below his arm and have him feel the way I move around the keyboard and the way my arm would work. And this, I think, sounds easier than it actually is, because demonstrating is one thing, but how they can understand what we're saying is often much more difficult. To give a small example, the way we would normally just say 1, 2, 3, 4, or okay, or this sign, for him, we could teach him, you put his hands in that position and you show him how to do it, but then you realize when he puts his hands up, it's often crooked, or the whole sense that we do easily, there's quite a few steps involved. And as I taught him, I slowly learned how I need to adjust my expression and how I needed to adjust my teaching so he could understand. He also got used to my style of teaching, and I think quite quickly we developed kind of our own personal language and our own personal way of communicating. During the lesson, we would obviously work on piano pieces, but because the lesson was long, it was 2 to 3 hours. So after about an hour or so, when we were getting, I felt like a little bit tired, we would take a break, have a drink, maybe a snack. And usually during this time, we would listen to a piece, listen to a CD. And sometimes we would listen to several pieces, or sometimes we would listen to the same piece and compare two different pianists' interpretation. And it was during this period that I realized how different our abilities were in certain aspects. For example, one time we were listening to a piece, and it was a Rachmaninoff piece, which has very, very much going on musically, a lot of counterpoint and many chords, for example, that have many notes at one time. And we were listening and he said, "Oh, a wrong note." And I said, "What?" He said, "Yeah, a wrong note. Why would they leave that in a recording?" He said, "Is it a live recording?" And I looked and I said, "No, it's a studio recording." And I said, "I didn't hear any wrong notes." And he said, "Yeah, go back." And so of course I went back and I listened again and I didn't hear anything. It sounded perfect to me. And I have some studio software, recording studio, that I could take it and just go in and listen to a very small part. And so he had me go back and forth to this one chord, which in a mass of about 8 or 9 notes, there was one middle voice that there was a note. It wasn't a wrong note, but the note, if we say on the piano, we have one note. The pianist had kind of hit the neighboring note slightly to make a slight smudge, only in that note. And anyway, that was an example of how it took me so long to understand that he, yes, he was very right. I didn't hear it at the beginning, and he had to point it out closer and closer until finally I could slow down enough to hear what he was hearing. And it was through this kind of these listening encounters that we had together that I realized I was with someone with a superpower. And it's very humble when you're teaching someone whose abilities exceed your own in certain ways. So I realized often that sometimes he would ask me questions about sounds. He would ask a sound about a bass note. When you play a bass note and you listen to the end, and he would ask about what I know are overtones, and I understand the theory of a lot of this, but often I didn't know what he was talking about because I couldn't hear things as clearly as he could. And so this actually became very important for our relationship. I think from this point, I realized that any question he had, I needed to take more time to listen a little bit deeper to find out what he was really talking about. And sometimes it was just from the outset that I didn't really grasp his question because he was asking a question about sound that I didn't quite understand. Please change the slide. If I can go back a minute. While we were in our lessons, besides listening to music, we also like to listen to crosstalk, which is Chinese xiangsheng in Mandarin. It's a form, two people are on stage, and it's usually a comic. It's two comedians, and they discuss culture or language or anything. And so we would listen to this a lot, and because we did this, listen to it a lot, often in our lessons we would imitate these crosstalk performers, and sometimes we would take on characters. I would become more serious or even more more angry than I would ever really become, but because we were acting, we were taking on characters, I could be this teacher and say, "Jiacheng, how are you doing that?" And I would pretend I'm this really tough teacher. And then he could also pretend that he was maybe a naughty child, a child who was talking back occasionally, which was so unlike his basic personality. And through this, we kind of developed, sometimes we would just play through music and talk about our music in these ways that became sometimes ridiculous, but we were always looking at it from the point of view of kind of humor. And because we started doing this, we just had this kind of chemistry that we could almost start up anytime and take on any topic and kind of riff on this topic or improvise. Then when he turned 16, he had an opportunity to go to Graz, Austria, to study at the Graz Conservatory. He was in Austria for 3.5 years, and when he returned to Taiwan, he auditioned and he got a permit to be a street musician. And at this time, as a street musician, he was doing quite well, but at that time, I had a sabbatical. And during my sabbatical, what I wanted to do was do a kind of performance where I could incorporate crosstalk and classical music. So since he had just come back and he was kind of my partner in the lessons, I asked him if he would like to do this with me. And of course he thought it would be fun. And so over a 4-month period, we created a show that we performed classical music, but we would talk about it and present it in a humorous way. And after we did our first performance, we showed this performance to a director here in Taiwan, and the director was interested in developing it with this. And so after this, we developed a show over 9 months that was called Tan Qing Shuo Ai, or in English, Just Play It. Please, to the next. So the show we created were the two of us sitting at two pianos, and we had five singers, these women who all of them sung, they all were dancers. One played the clarinet, another played the flute, and they would occasionally come on stage and interact with us while we were doing our show and talking about the music. Little did we know this would catch on pretty quickly, and we soon had a few tours that led to performances both here in Taiwan and in mainland China. And please go to the next slide. And during the performances, one of the most important things we needed to do was make my student, Zhe Cheng, learn how to move around on the stage. And so during our months where we were creating the show, he slowly became comfortable with how to move from one piano to the other, how to walk out on the stage, where was the dangerous part of the stage, which he couldn't go any further. And while he was out there, he also developed his way through echolocation, through hearing, to know where he was and how to get back to the piano. And please go to the next slide. And we did many different pieces, often where we would put together pieces that were classical music and also music that was in the more popular, in the popular genre. For example, we would take the Hallelujah chorus, Hallelujah, and we would talk about an aspect of this, but then we would come and talk about the Leonard Cohen song, Hallelujah. Or a Ray Charles song, Hallelujah, I Love You So. And so we would put these together kind of in a medley. Please go to the next slide. Here we are with Stan Lai, the director of Performance Workshop, one of the top theater groups in Asia. And we worked with him to promote our shows. Please go to the next slide. After we began these shows, our relationship had certainly developed. He was already by this point 22 years old. We had known each other for 11 years, and we had by this time we had started performing all over China. And besides performing, we had much to do together. We ate together. We were backstage so often together. Please go to the next slide. And we often had a lot of time in these moments to discuss many things in life. And I think it was there that I really learned about how my experiences and hers and his were completely different, and definitely made me humble in a lot of ways to understand how I really need to listen to others more. I guess you could say that. Please go to the next slide. We also got the chance to do some TV shows. This is a show in Beijing that we went on. Please go to the next slide. We were also in another one. This is Xiao Ao Jianghu, a TV show that's in Shanghai. And through these shows, we also got to create on the spot and do a lot of kind of improvisation. And so we learned a lot together about how to live and work with each other. Please go to the next slide. Now we have a new show called Sheng Sheng Bu Shi, which we've been performing here locally, and we're hoping after the pandemic that we'll get an opportunity to be able to move more worldwide with this show. Please go to the last slide. And the one thing we still do besides work is we also do try to have fun together. Besides performing, riding on a bicycle built for two was one thing we were, I think this is in Hangzhou, Our hotel had one of these bikes, but we definitely like to try to find some non-work experiences to do together. And now, Xu Jiacheng is now 35. So we've known each other now for almost 25 years. And it's been a wonderful experience that has really changed my life and my outlook on life and how I deal with people. Thank you very much. If anyone has any questions about my experience with Xu Jiacheng, now would be the time.
Thank you, John, for sharing your story. I see a lot of questions in the chat box, but I think we only have time for one question. And then we'll leave all the questions until the roundtable discussion at the end. The question to you for now is, in your show, there were a lot of stylistic differences. You were playing Bach, you were also playing like folk music, you were playing popular music like Jay Chou, and you were also playing some standard repertoire. The question to you is, how did you make the teaching like successful in terms of teaching all the stylistic difference? Especially, I would say that the contrapuntal part is, for me, the most difficult to teach in terms of piano teaching. So can you share some experience on that?
Sure. As far as the different styles, that was one thing early on that I wanted him to learn. Because in Taipei here, when he started, they didn't have very much access to Braille scores. So his learning was all done through recording. And obviously this, I thought it was important to develop his ear. So part of our lesson would be improvisation. And one of the things that I started with him was just to take any piece, Happy Birthday. But he would have to start from any note I would give. I'll start from this one. And he would have to figure the notes. And then we slowly got into how to harmonize. And for most of this, I took popular songs or folk songs. This was a part of every lesson to do different kinds of styles. Then we would do lessons where I would just kind of start playing and he would join in, and perhaps I would start with an accompaniment and he would be the solo. And now I was going, he didn't know, it wasn't a particular song, so he perhaps wouldn't know the chord progression. He'd just have to use his ear. And while we were going, sometimes when we would go, I'd go to where almost he would know the next chord, but then I would go to a different chord and do an interesting modulation so that he was always listening and always being prepared to any cues that would lead him to a different harmony. And I think through this, he developed a very sensitive reaction to music. And when we did otherwise popular music or folk songs, this was, for him, I thought, very, very easy and very natural. You brought up counterpoint as opposed to, say, for example, Bach and that kind of music, which is very complicated. And yes, I agree, this is probably the most difficult to teach to any students, sighted or visually handicapped as well. So I think this is not easy, but I often just end up splitting the counterpoint up very easily to just the most important voice and the less important, and first do those. And while doing that, I think it's important to be able to sing both parts. Usually our mind will follow the main melody. And so we can, for example, happy birthday to you. We can do that. But to do re la, to be able to sing the bass voice, I think is one thing that in the beginning can be very difficult. But if a student is used to doing that, it becomes natural. And to me, this was, I realized this was a very good way to teach counterpoint and get students over the hump of the difficulties of this counterpoint. And like, for example, like I was just doing before, like this kind of juggling, it seems difficult at first and it creates a little panic within ourselves. But after you realize that you can just switch your focus and your attention from one voice or one ball to the other, then the counterpoint becomes much easier.
Right. Thank you so much, John. We look forward to talking with you more later in the roundtable discussion. And now
sure.
We have to move on to our third speaker, George Mann from the United Kingdom. Mann is the co-artistic director of Ad Infinitum. Mann founded Ad Infinitum in 2007, writing, directing, and performing in the company's debut piece, Behind the Mirror. Mann received the Stage Best Solo Performer Award in 2009 for Odyssey, his one-man performance of Homer's classic tale directed by Nir Paldi. George wrote, directed, and performed in Translunar Paradise. The piece has received 9 awards to date and toured around the world. We are honored to have George Mann here to share on the topic, the benefits and challenges of collaborative and inclusive theater making. 共用劇場製作的協作，機遇與挑戰。 George, please.
Hello, I'm George. I'm male with short brown hair and a beard, wearing a light blue shirt and glasses. I'm co-artistic director of Ad Infinitum, a touring theatre company and charity based in Bristol, United Kingdom, and founded in 2007. And I'm delighted to be here with you today. But I have to be honest, it wasn't supposed to be like this. Next slide, please. Thanks. Originally, as the director of Extraordinary Wall of Silence, which you can watch online as part of No Limits Wonderful Festival, I was asked to come and give a presentation here today, but I couldn't do that alone. You see, at Ad Infinitum, although we use the title director, in a collaborative devising company, it has a different meaning. We don't work in a traditionally hierarchical way. In our rehearsal rooms, everyone's voice counts. Everyone can and does contribute to the creation of new devised theatre pieces. So in a way, we're all writers, creators, visionaries, from the actors through to the stage managers, to the designers and audiences who often contribute stories and testimony to the theatre that we make. As director, I'm not bringing my singular vision to a piece of theatre. I'm a guide, a facilitator, or a navigator moving our team through a challenging, sometimes messy, sometimes joyful, and always complex creative process that leads to the completion of a new piece of theatre. But it's theatre in which we all feel a sense of ownership. It's ours, not mine. Next slide, please. And this is certainly the case with our production of Extraordinary Wall of Silence. It explores the personal, political, and historical impact of the 1880 Milan Conference that banned sign language in deaf education. It's a production that's only possible because of the collaboration of our deaf colleagues, artists, and members of the deaf community who contributed their sweat, we're a very physical theatre company, energy, creativity, ideas, and true stories. Because woven into the production is a culture, a deaf culture, sign language, and lived experience that no hearing person could accurately represent. Extraordinary Wall of Silence is the outcome of a very specific group of deaf and hearing people coming together to collaborate. So that's why I couldn't come to this event alone. The presentation needed to be a collaboration too. So I asked longstanding Ad Infinitum collaborator Matthew Gurney to help me do it. Next slide, please. Now you might be wondering, where on earth is Matthew? Well, sadly, Matthew is ill and he can't be with us today. But rather than cancel, we agreed that I could present material we planned together and share with you excerpts from video interviews of Matty so he can offer his own points of view and reflection. So I asked Matty, how did we end up making Extraordinary Wall of Silence together? Video one, please.
Well, there's a few little different elements that came together. So I've been working with Theatre Ad Infinitum. I was involved in a play called Light, and it wasn't about deaf people or anything to do with deafness, but we've worked together, we've collaborated, and the director, George Mann, saw me suffer through issues with funding for interpreters through the government scheme, access to work. He's seen that we had struggled with that. And then we started talking about discrimination and access and barriers for the deaf community. And so this has been a 5-year process, really, a process of devising. It's been a long process to bring this play together.
Thanks. Light was our first collaboration together, a sci-fi inspired by Edward Snowden's revelations and state surveillance that conjures an Orwellian future where a totalitarian regime monitors the thoughts of its citizens through implants. The play takes place in complete darkness, and the actors use LED torchlight to convey a fast-moving, non-verbal thriller. Here's a short interview the BBC did back in 2013. Video 2, please.
Inspired by an encounter with Matty at a workshop at the Bush Theatre, George and Matty together took Light in a new and unexpected direction.
How did I get involved with theatre ad infinitum? Well, last year they asked me to be involved in a project doing research and development on disability hate crime. They asked me because they felt having a deaf person's knowledge and background would be useful. So I agreed to work with them, and somehow I got on really well with them. And since then, I've never looked back.
He did a workshop with me a few months ago, you know, and it was very challenging for him. He came into an environment that was predominantly hearing, and he did a really brave thing and just did this workshop, you know. And I think it was a real challenge for both of us because I wanted to include Matty and he wanted to do it. And I think, you know, he's always challenging himself, he's always doing that. And it's brilliant because it's opened up, I think, a whole world of possibility for him, but also for us.
So in our planning sessions for this presentation, I asked Matty to recall what it was really like to collaborate with Ad Infinitum on Light, starting in 2012. Next slide, please. Matty responded by saying, "The play was exciting, but I didn't realise it would be in the dark. I had never experienced anything like that before. It was very hard in rehearsals, the hardest weeks in my professional life." "In what way?" I asked, and he replied, "The lights were off, so I was always thinking, where is the interpreter? I can't see." When we first started rehearsing Light, it was a real struggle. Turning the lights on and off all day, every day to practice with the torches was hard. We were working with two British Sign Language interpreters in the room, but for Matty, if you turn the lights off, no one can see each other, so any communication in sign language is lost. Matty told me, "Eventually, someone got the idea of using head torches, pointing down over the face and hands of the interpreters. But it was still hard, trying not to bump into each other. My eyes were so tired, searching through the dark. I was shattered at the end of every day. But it was also great. It was an opportunity to overcome that barrier, teach deaf awareness, and we devised a way of communicating between deaf and hearing people in the room that led to a really rich way of working together." Matty is being very generous, I think. He told me that over time, as we got to know each other, he felt more comfortable to tell Ad Infinitum the truth about what he needed and what we were not doing so well. He said, "I could be more open. I realised it was a lack of deaf awareness. Also, my relationships improved as people learned to sign. We could have a laugh, a drink together." When I reflect on that time, knowing what I know now, I cringe. We made so many mistakes. There was so much to learn, and we're still learning, by the way. And I can see the burden on Matty as the only deaf actor in what was a hearing environment. Next slide, please. These reflections on our work together over the last 10 years are important because they demonstrate that our journey towards working inclusively was complex, difficult at times, but it enabled Extraordinary Wall of Silence to happen. Here's a video of Nadeem Islam interviewing Matty and asking him about the 1880 Milan Conference. Video 3, please.
Yeah, the 1880 Milan Congress was where, prior to that, sign language was used in education. People like Abbé de Lepe was teaching in Paris, setting up the first school for deaf children.
That was the first school.
And Alexander Graham Bell came along and kind of said, "No, we want oralism." So they established this congress, and it was attended by hearing people. There was only one deaf person, one 1111. This is an international conference. One deaf person attending this. And it was this Congress that decided that sign language was not good for deaf kids and that everyone should learn to speak. So can you imagine, you know, this one deaf person completely steamrolled by, bulldozed by all of those hearing people. And after that, you know, sign language use, well, sign language is suppressed.
When I first learned about that conference, it was a moment of disbelief for me, but it was also a moment in which everything made sense. All of the barriers that exist between deaf and hearing people, you could trace most, if not all of them, back to the extremely harmful decision they made at that conference, which decimated deaf communities for over a century and damaged the connections between deaf and hearing people. I asked Matty, what were the challenges in staging Extraordinary Wall of Silence? Video number 4, please.
So this play is a bilingual piece of theatre. So we have to think about the challenges of the timing and the structure, because actually British Sign Language grammar structure is different to English. So we had to work out how we could make both languages work at the same time without one language running ahead without the other. So actually this process has taken a lot of research and development phases to explore the both languages, to explore how a bilingual play can be accessible to both a deaf and a hearing audience, and how everyone can have an equal access to this play.
I remember that one of the major challenges in our bilingual production was timing. Deb Pugh is the only hearing actor on stage, and she voices the British Sign Language, or BSL. There were times when what BSL could convey in 30 seconds sometimes took 10, 20, or even 30 seconds longer to convey in English. How could we sync everything up so it worked seamlessly? Kyra Pollitt, one of the BSL interpreters working with us on the show, helpfully asked us to imagine an igloo and a red brick house. Both are homes, so there's a lot shared in common. But if you build a red brick house in the North Pole, it wouldn't keep you warm, just as you can't build an igloo in the United Kingdom because it would melt. Sometimes you have to recognize and celebrate cultural differences. And so it was with Extraordinary Wall of Silence. We often came across what we began to call igloo brick moments and embraced them as differences between culture and language within the play. This meant we couldn't sync every moment of the show. We had to accept that at times the show is experienced differently by deaf and hearing audiences. But there were also a lot of beautiful moments of connection and things we shared in common. Ad Infinitum's work has been described as having a signature of physical storytelling style. I asked Matty, do you think that this works well with deaf theatre culture, BSL, and your own physical practice? Video 5, please.
Yes, absolutely. I think Theatre Ad Infinitum focus on physical and very visual storytelling, and that really, really relates to sign language, because our language is a visual language, so actually it's a perfect match, and it's been a really rich collaboration, and it's been a really wonderful opportunity to show our stories. So yeah, I think it's a perfect match.
Ad Infinitum have learnt so much from collaborating with Matty. He brought deaf culture, sign language and deaf theatre practice into the company, something we knew nothing about. This signature style I mentioned is something that's evolving all the time. And collaborating with Matty and with our other deaf colleagues has changed the company and the theatre we make for the better. Within the hearing majority, when we meet our deaf peers, there is a danger that we might fall into wearing what author Harlan Lane calls the mask of benevolence, becoming the do-gooders who are here to help, to teach, or who sometimes see their role as an act of giving. This is that sticky, viscous and destructive attitude handed down to us by the 18th and 19th century colonists and eugenicists that believed they were part of a superior race. Their arrogant and ignorant ideas have insidiously seeped into our modern lives. And so it's not uncommon to this day to find hearing people wearing the mask of benevolence when they attempt to form relationships with deaf peers. Living as we do in our colonialist world, we all have a responsibility to continually work against what has been, for over 100 years, a hearing hegemony that has allowed the destructive movement of oralism to flourish on an international scale. In order to be allies, we need to self-educate, take responsibility, learn from our mistakes, and I've made loads, listen to our deaf peers and be led by them. Relationships, like the one shared between Matty and Ad Infinitum, system don't go one way. If we're working towards inclusive cultures, it's about genuine collaboration. Stay with this slide, please. Speaking of collaboration, I want to take a moment to acknowledge just how much I've learned from a colleague and good friend that Matty introduced me to, Dr. Paddy Ladd, a deaf academic and activist also based in Bristol. Dr. Ladd, through his academic writing, multiple lectures, mentoring and support, effectively tutored the Extraordinary Wall of Silence cast and Ad Infinitum team, taking us on an educational journey to help us all better understand deaf culture, deaf history, and the importance of sign languages. I highly recommend that you read Dr. Ladd's seminal book, Understanding Deaf Culture in Search of Deafhood, which you can see here. Next slide, please. Let's conclude by thinking about collaborative inclusive theatre making in the UK. Here, theatre is predominantly made using a model whereby a playwright writes a play in English, which is then rehearsed and staged, usually in 3 to 4 weeks, and then performed. This model places heavy emphasis on text, and therefore written and spoken English. But of course, if your first language is British Sign Language, a visual language, and part of an entirely different culture, and if your main way of accessing the theatre world is by working in English in a hearing culture, you're at a disadvantage. Ad Infinitum's creative process has been created over 15 years and allows us to devise theatre collaboratively over 10 to 12 weeks before it sees the stage. Because our way of working veers away from the industry norm, over the years we've had to explain and sometimes justify our process, but not to our deaf colleagues. They just get it. And because we devise theatre through improvisation, our deaf colleagues have a voice in the room. They contribute on their own terms, bringing their culture, language and practice, and influencing every aspect of the theatre that we make. Next slide, please. So, as Ad Infinitum has become an ally to the deaf colleagues we work with, so colleagues like Matty have become allies of the work we make and a proud part of our team. Making Extraordinary Wall of Silence was so important to the cast, creative team and our company. But the fact that this type of show is something of a rarity demonstrates that we need to do more to broaden our perspectives, ensure the arts sector is open to and values other ways of creating theatre, and to work together to bring about much needed change. That way, in the future, collaborative work like this could become less rare, and the extraordinary wall of silence between deaf and hearing people might finally begin to collapse. I'm going to finish with Matty talking about what he hopes people will get out of watching Extraordinary Wall of Silence and about the future. Video 6, please.
Well, I'm hoping that when the play's finished, I hope that the audience will go home and do their own research into the local deaf community, maybe some international deaf work, or maybe they might think about deaf people in the future. That's my aim. So I want to show that deaf and hearing people can work together. We don't have to work in silos. And deaf people have got these incredible skills, but it's about a skill sharing. If people think that deaf people can't do things, and that's the representation that's out in the media, that deaf people can't do things, people are going to be brainwashed, and this aim is to show people that is not the case.
So if you want to know more about Ad Infinitum or the research behind Extraordinary Wall of Silence, we've made a resource pack for you with books, videos and more that you can dive into, and it will be sent to you after the event. I'll also put our website address and my email in the chat, just in case you have any questions or want to know more about us. Thank you so much for having me and for watching.
Thank you, George and Virtual Matty, for sharing your work. I see a few questions in the chat box, and I would like to read them to you now. The first question is the awareness of deaf culture higher in UK these years?
That's a really good question. I think it's starting to change. We've just had a celebrity dancing contest on TV that featured a profoundly deaf contestant, Rose Ayling Ellis, and she worked really hard to raise deaf awareness in the UK through that event, and did an amazing job. So it is beginning to change, but I have no comparison to other cultures and countries because I don't live there. But after a long period of of difficulty, shall we say. It feels like there's the potential and the possibility of change, and I really hope that that continues.
Yeah, that's great to know. Now, apart from the deaf, does Ad Infinitum also work with people of other disabilities, like the people who are visually impaired or physically disabled?
Yeah, Ad Infinitum we prioritise work with anyone from an underrepresented or marginalised background. We're currently working with a company also based in Bristol who are diverse-led, and an artistic director, Jamie Bedard. So yeah, the answer is yes, and we've done many different types of work with many different people from different backgrounds, and in the future we will continue to do that.
Yeah. Great. I have a personal question for you. In terms of working with people of different backgrounds, what is your greatest take?
My greatest take is that throughout history, I think human cultures have feared and been scared of diversity. But my experience of diversity is that it's so beautiful. There's so much we can all learn from diversity and from people from many different backgrounds. We have everything to gain. So my biggest take is, yes, it can be complex and challenging. I certainly make mistakes, as I said, and I don't always get it right. But I think if you're always coming from a place of compassion, empathy, and trying your best, then we all stand to I guess, progress as people, as groups, as societies. And that's my biggest takeaway. And that's also my hope for us as a people as we move forward.
Thanks. Now, for the final question for this section, what is the planning or initial ideas for your next production that you're having in mind?
Our next major production is working with older adults, and my co-artistic director, Nia Paldi, is leading that. It's called The Long Lie, and it will weave together stories and testimonies from people who care for older adults, from older adults themselves, some with conditions such as dementia or Alzheimer's, and it will weave together those stories to try and convey, I guess, the state of the system here in the UK, whether that's working or not for care for older adults, and it will explore vulnerabilities and what we might need to think about as we move into the future. Again, this theme of the future, because I think a lot of our work is about raising awareness about the state of things and asking our audiences to think about this and think about what they can do, what we can all do to change things for the better.
Thank you so much, George. We are now going to have a short break of 5 minutes, and please come back 5 minutes later. We will then start the part two panel discussion. Thank you very much. Hello, welcome back. After the third floor sharing by overseas artists, we will now start part two panel discussion to continue in exploring the sustainable practices in nurturing disability arts, together with our local experts, Grace Chang, Ma Hon Ming, and Mimi Lo. This part will be conducted in Cantonese and English. Please select your preferred language on the top left corner of the screen. Now I will switch to Cantonese. 在進行小組討論之前，我想先邀請三位喺本地有豐富經驗嘅專家，簡單介紹一下自己喺共融藝術領域上面嘅一啲實踐經驗，同埋就上一部分嘅主題分享一下你嘅想法同埋回應。 或者我首先介紹同埋邀請Grace， 鄭蟬琪Grace係香港展能藝術會副主席同埋節目委員會聯合主席。佢相信藝術為生命帶嚟無限可能，致力以中介者身份將藝術帶入社群，鼓勵大眾透過唔同嘅感官享受藝術。香港展能藝術會多年嚟通過培育藝術教育，發掘咗唔少具潛質嘅視覺藝術同埋表演藝術嘅展能藝術家。 我而家將時間交俾Grace同大家更加詳細嘅分享。Grace有請。Hello，
大家，我係Grace。咁咧，我係一個短頭髮嘅女士啦，戴眼鏡。咁而家咧，我著住黑色嘅衫嘅一條裙。咁今日咧，我介紹嘅就係展能藝術會啦。我咧就喺二零。 唔係，對唔住，應該係1999年度咧開始咧，我就已經幫手或者我以義工嘅身份咧去服侍呢一個機構香港展能藝術會。咁展能藝術會咧其實係喺1986年開始成立嘅，其實個目的好簡單嘅，其實就係講緊我哋希望呢個藝術真係俾每一個人，無論係唔係傷殘或者係唔係展能，咁所以呢個係其實我哋一個好重要嘅一個我哋嘅諗法，我哋希望藝術係俾到每一個人嘅。睇翻我哋嘅 focus 啦，其實咧我哋咧要做嘅嘢咧，其實係有橫向啦，亦都有中向嘅。咁咧其中一個咧好重要，對唔住啊，睇翻呢個 slide 係啦。其中一個好重要嘅咧，我要睇睇先，唔好意思。咁喺我哋嘅 focus 入邊咧，有幾樣嘢我哋好緊要嘅。首先第一樣就係藝術嘅普及啦，第二樣藝術嘅教育啦，咁同埋藝術家佢專業嘅發展。另外仲有而家我哋做得好多嘅就係一個藝術嘅通達服務。我哋希望透過共融，我哋希望透過社會企業啦，我哋希望透過我哋推廣共融咧，可以令到有更多嘅人去理解其實展能藝術喺香港可以發展成點樣。另外好開心，我哋好多時都有機會去到唔同嘅國家去分享我哋香港藝術家嘅一啲嘅展能藝術嘅一啲嘅表演啦，或者一啲嘅展示啦。咁呢個都係一個我哋香港展能藝術會我哋好希望能夠可以推動嘅一樣嘢嚟嘅。咁咧跟住咧，我就想介紹我哋兩個嘅計劃。一個計劃咧就主要係以一個專業藝術發展為主啦，另一個咧就係以一個教育為主嘅一個計劃嚟嘅。咁而家你睇到嘅呢個叫藝無疆啦，我哋嘅英文叫 Cross All Borders， 其實咧就係由2009年開始成立嘅一個我哋叫做展演啦，我哋唔想叫比賽。咁咧係咧，我哋係邀請全香港嘅一啲展能藝術家啦，佢哋將佢哋嘅作品送到嚟我哋度，我哋一齊希望能夠有機會可以展示啦。咁我哋每一年咧，一年嘅係視覺藝術，一年咧係表演藝術。咁就由2009年做到而家啊，都其實已經好多年啦。咁當中咧，其實我哋希望喺入邊咧，我哋可以發掘到一啲藝術家啦，希望可以持續嘅培育，而希望令到佢哋咧係可以以藝術作為佢哋主要嘅發展嘅方向嘅。另外呢一個咧係藝延伸嘅計劃啦，我哋由2016年開始，我冇記錯啊。咁呢個計劃咧其實好重要嘅就係我哋入到學校，我哋邀請藝術家入到唔同嘅一啲嘅學校入邊啦。咁主要係一啲嘅特殊學校，我哋希望咧藉住由一個叫做比較細嘅小朋友，由嗰陣時開始培養佢哋對藝術嘅興趣，亦都希望佢哋理解藝術入面當中一啲唔同嘅部分啦，而通過呢一種持續嘅計劃咧，讓佢哋可以有機會掌握到藝術嘅一啲嘅技巧啦，從而佢以藝術去表達佢自己嘅。呢啲咧係一啲少少嘅我哋一啲嘅分享啦，一啲朋友佢哋自己做嘅一啲嘅創作啦。咁呢樣嘢咧，其實我諗對於我嚟講，我喺展能藝術會已經好多年服侍呢個機構，好重要一樣嘢其實。我想 share 翻即係幾位海外嘅朋友，佢講一樣嘢，即係我覺得好緊要就係，其實好多時可能講緊我哋去服侍佢哋，但係倒翻轉頭，我哋獲益嘅係更加多咯，謝謝。
多謝 Grace 講緊香港展能藝術會嘅工作。接住落嚟咧，我想邀請香港耀能協會賽馬會田以玲學校音樂老師嘅馬漢銘老師。馬 Sir 從事教學工作超過20年，曾修讀視藝，而家除了教音樂之外，亦都是校風和學生支援範疇主管。他年輕的時候加入過銀樂隊，負責吹小號，至今仍然經常持續領導不同能力的學生參加音樂節演出和帶領學校的銅管樂團。馬 Sir 有請。
Hey, 大家好啊！咁我咧就係馬 Sir 啦。咁我今日咧就著咗一件黑色嘅衫啦，我戴眼鏡啦，一頭短嘅攣髮嘅。咁頭先咧都講咗啦，咁我就係嚟自香港耀能協會賽馬會田以玲學校啦。咁我咧都可以簡單都介紹一下我哋嘅學校俾大家認識一下。 係啦，咁我哋學校咧，其實係一間肢體傷殘嘅特殊學校啦。咁我哋有宿舍啦，其實全校嘅學生咧，大約有90位到啦。咁佢哋咧就會由6歲啦，到18歲啦，即係成個小學同埋中學嘅階段咧，都會喺我哋學校嗰度度過嘅。咁我哋嘅同學咧，除咗有肢體傷殘嘅問題之外啦，咁其實佢哋都會有輕度智障啦、中度智障啦，都有普通智能嘅學生喺我哋嘅學校當中嘅。咁主要佢哋嘅病症啦，有腦麻痹啦、肌肉萎縮啦，或者係半身痉挛等等嘅。好，咁咧講一講我工作啦。其實除咗教藝術之外啦，咁其實我都好長時間啦。98年咧就已經入職啦嚇。咁頭先都講過其實我會安排好多唔同嘅課外活動啦，俾啲同學嘅。咁除咗藝術嘅活動啦，可能學校一般旅行啊、聯歡會啊等等噶啦，我都會負責嘅。咁同埋我哋都覺得咧家長啦，無論喺學業啦，或者喺學習藝術啦，唔同嘅範疇咧都好有幫助嘅，對於同學仔，咁我都會負責個家長工作啦，嚇。咁同埋社區上面啦，我哋都會同唔同嘅團體去到合作啦，希望可以擴闊同學仔嘅眼界啦，嚇。咁啊，多啲帶佢哋去唔同嘅地方去到表演啊，或者參與一啲唔同嘅藝術嘅活動等等啦。係啦，咁其實我除咗教音樂啦，我仲會教中文啦，嚇。咁啊，會有啲其他學習經歷嘅活動啦，同埋咧都會為一啲18歲將會離校嘅學生咧做一啲嘅準備，希望咧佢哋可以更加容易咁樣啦，可以去到融入翻個社會嘅。好，咁咧主要睇下我喺藝術方面嘅工作啦。咁其實有一隊嘅銅管樂團啦，咁就係2006年嗰陣成立啦。咁其實咧人數一路都唔多啦，因為其實我哋學校都係得大約90至100人到啦。咁啊初期就8位同學仔啦，咁啊到最多嘅時候咧就有12個啦。咁佢哋就主要係吹小號啦、圓號啦、長號啦同埋大號嘅。咁咧好多人都問咧點解係銅管樂團啊，而唔係木管啊，又冇弦樂咧啊？咁一來本身我自己係吹小號啦，咁同埋咧其實我都發覺咧，其實因為銅管樂器咧都係得3粒掣啊嚇，或者係長號啦，咁啊有伸縮啦嗰條管啦，咁相對我哋嘅同學仔咧係容易啲去到掌握嘅啊，因為咧。佢哋好多嘅未必能夠雙手去到協調得到啦，咁有啲佢可能左手會靈活啲嘅，咁可能就可以吹圓號啦，右手靈活啲咧就可以吹小號，咁另一隻手可能冇咁靈活咧，就去固定支樂器咁啦，咁都有呢一啲嘅考慮啦，咁大家見到相入邊嗰班同學仔啦，其實我哋都有好多唔同嘅演出嘅經驗啦，咁都係啦，經常我哋都會去社區啦去到表演啦或者啲典禮啦都有啲唔同嘅機構啊學校都會邀請我哋去演出嘅。咁啲相片啦，大家都見到咁有好多唔同嘅場合，我哋會喺公開嘅場合啦，就算喺街檔，我哋落雨啦，我哋都照做啦。咁左下角有一幅咧，咁我哋係同一個香港專業嘅一隊青年嘅樂團啦，一齊喺大會堂演奏啦。咁我都好希望同學仔咧，即係可以除咗自己去表演之外咧，都去同一啲唔同嘅人去到 join 佢哋，去到一齊去到表演啦，去到擴闊佢哋嘅眼界啦。咁咧2013年啦，咁呢個係一個我哋銅管樂團嘅自己嘅音樂會啦，其實都唔容易去做嘅。咁我哋當年咧就 book 咗沙田大會堂文娛廳啦，咁大約300個座位啦。咁其實嗰一次咧，對於團員啦，同埋對我都係一個好印象深刻啊，好難忘。因為去到音樂會完結咧，都係冇人走嘅。好少有嘅呢個情況咧嚇，咁係好開心啦，班團員。好咁咧，其實我仲有其他嘅藝術工作都會做啦，咁會請啲藝術家嚟學校嗰啲演出啊、分享啦，其實戲劇班啦，香港學校戲劇節啊都會有參加嘅。咁咧係啦，咁呢個其實我仲會同啲佢啲共融嘅活動運動啦。咁最後咧，好想講咧，哎呀，去唔去得翻咧？其實好咁唔緊要啦。咁最後我覺得同學仔咧，佢哋嘅努力咧係好值得得到掌聲咯。但我唔希望佢哋係得到啲同情啊嘅掌聲，而佢哋嘅能力咧係真係俾社會認同嘅。係啦，我分享係咁多啦，唔該曬。
好多謝阿馬 Sir 講佢學校嘅一啲工作同埋活動。而家我想邀請香港舞者、編舞家同埋多媒體導演盧淑嫻 Mimi。Mimi 同時係兩口米嘅創始人兼藝術總監，近年致力推動接觸即興共融發展，在亞洲地區少有同時研習新意內導研究、舞動所能、親子接觸、接觸即興等範疇的香港藝術家。有請 Mimi。
Hello， 大家好啊，我是 Mimi。咁我係短頭髮嘅，戴咗眼鏡啦。咁我著黑色衫，咁我就有一個紅色、橙色、紫色混合嘅披肩啊。咁啊，係啦，頭先都有介紹聽到我講啦，就係、是、我係 Mimi 啦，我係兩口米，即、就、係、是、Mimi Low Performing Arts Development Foundation 嘅創辦人同埋藝術總監。咁我本身自己就係香港演藝學院舞蹈學院畢業嘅。咁其實我而家咧，亦都係翻翻去學院嗰度度有任教啦。咁其中任教主要嘅咧，就係有一科叫做接觸即興 （contact improvisation）。咁呢一個學科咧，亦都係我而家主要去推行嘅一個方向。咁所以咧，我嘅團隊咧，其實同我而家做嘅嘢咧，就係由接觸即興呢一個方開始。咁輕輕講少少啦，接觸即興咧本身就係一個透過肢體互動，我哋會係即興嘅一個舞蹈，但係咧就唔係淨係自己跳，我哋好著重就係人同人之間嘅嗰個互動。咁所以咧，我哋喺接觸即興嘅延伸咧，其實延伸落嚟咧有幾樣嘢啦，其中一個咧就係叫做 danceability， 我哋中文咧就叫佢做舞動所能。咁本身始創人咧，佢嘅諗法就係我哋係咪可以將 contact improv 呢一樣嘢帶到去俾所有嘅人咧？我哋例如坐輪椅嘅朋友啊，或者係有身體唔同能力、聽障、視障各樣狀況嘅朋友，我哋係咪都可以一齊互動咧？咁所以咧，我哋就整理咗有 danceability 舞動所能嘅呢一種舞蹈方式。咁仲有另一個延伸咧，就係叫做 contact kiss 親子接觸啦。咁呢個咧最簡單嘅理解咧，就係一個親子版，即係話接觸即興咧就係兩個大人跳嘅。咁但係咧呢一個 contact kiss 就係可能係爸爸媽媽同埋小朋友一個親子互動版嘅。咁我哋都令到大家對於大人小朋友可以一齊跳舞嘅呢一樣嘢咧，多咗一個延伸。那個同等的理念咧，係我哋頭先提及呢三樣嘢咧，都好重視嘅一樣嘢。我哋係舞者與舞者之間，儘管譬如我哋話親子係大人同細路，我哋大人同細路嘅身份咧都係平等嘅。喺呢個舞蹈嘅過程裏邊咧，大家係一個 dance partner， 就再唔係一個父母去教小朋友嘅呢一種關係。咁另外一個咧就係叫做 somatics 啦，新意內導研究。咁呢一個咧，其實就係補足緊一啲我哋一般跳舞嘅 form 咧比較缺少嘅一個部分，就係話由自己第一身個身體去感覺出發。因為好多時跳舞咧，我哋都會著重可能係外邊你睇到個身體，可能你跟住個老師嘅一啲動作形態去學習。咁但係我哋頭先講嘅呢幾個舞蹈形式咧，佢都唔係外邊可以睇到嘅，反而係透過你第一身嘅感覺，你知道你個身體嘅感知，你點樣透過互動去同人哋做交流，去同人做溝通嘅。咁咧我嘅團隊除咗就喺一啲學校啊，或者係透過譬如頭先阿 Grace 都佢係展能藝術會，我哋有透過佢哋呢一啲機構咧，咁我本身自己嘅團隊咧都有一啲自己做緊嘅一啲計劃。近年咧就係有一個叫做社區文化大使計劃，咁我哋咧就將頭先我提及嘅呢幾個舞蹈方式咧就帶到去社區。咁譬如咧，你哋喺相裏邊度見到咧，其中係我去年的其中一個場次，我們透過一個公開的又有講座，我們會做示範，也都會請參加者是可以親身可以來跳舞。在場呢那個小朋友呢其實只是一歲半，但後面呢有一位婆婆呢，白頭髮的婆婆呢，其實她已經92歲了。同場我們還有輪椅的朋友，我覺得這個起碼我們就是讓人去經歷一次，原來我們是可以不同年紀不同身體能力是可以同時間一起參與在同一個舞蹈裡面的。我們除了 淨係去社區之外咧，其實我哋都希望嗰啲參加者咧係有機會可以做演出嘅。咁所以我哋喺呢個計劃裏邊咧，唔單止係俾佢哋參加工作坊，唔止係體驗，佢哋咧亦都有機會咧係可以去到一個舞台嗰度咧，係去展示佢哋嘅演出。咁呢個亦都係俾觀眾有機會睇到，咦，原來一啲唔同能力嘅朋友可以一齊跳舞，然後可以成為一個演出嘅。咁啊，呢一個剛巧就有一個機會咧，就係有歌德學院嘅邀請啦。咁我咧就拍咗一個dance film， 一個舞蹈嘅電影。咁佢咧其實就係記錄咗部分我頭先講我哋文化大事嘅嘢啦。咁最重要嘅咧就係我哋想講，究竟嗰個跳唔跳到舞係個身體，定係你嘅諗法咧？咁所以我個電影裏邊其中有一句，我就係舞動身體嘅可能與否，到底係身體嘅狀況，定係心裏邊嗰句說不嘅聲音？咁好希望大家去諗下，原來係諗法可能係更加影響咗你身體唔同狀況咧。其實你都係可以跳到舞嘅。咁啊，最後而家文化大使咧，我係會繼續做緊啦。我哋嚟緊係第三年啦。咁同時間亦都同無限量做咗唔同嘅合作。2019年佢哋第一屆做咗啦。咁啊，今年亦都剛巧繼續同佢哋做緊一啲合作嘅。咁我嘅介紹就係咁多，唔該曬。
多謝曬 Mimi 講佢最近嘅一啲唔同嘅計劃。I would like to now invite Anthony, George, and John back to the discussion, and we'll talk about the sustainability of disability performance and art. 喺開始嘅時候，我想問下，即係各位對於喺訓練之後點樣可以提升更加多嘅演出機會俾唔同背景嘅人士咧？或者不如 Grace 開始先啦。
對於展覽藝術會嚟講咧，其實我哋係做緊持續嘅一啲叫做培育嘅一啲嘅計劃嘅。咁點樣可以令到佢哋有更多嘅可能性咧？其實我覺得係其實都係睇緊我哋點樣去揾一啲可能性，即係呢一樣嘢。無論喺我哋講嘅所謂社會上面啦，可能喺嘅場地上面啦，喺政府上面，喺唔同嘅層面上面咧，我哋點樣去揾到一啲可能性咯？咁呢樣嘢係我哋持續地喺度做緊嘅一樣嘢咯，係喎。
For example, Anthony, can you tell us a little bit of your experience in Cambodia? How would you, or how often would it be possible to create performances or curate performances in Cambodia?
It's a great question, and I think it's something that I've heard amongst all the speakers. Actually, I mean, the short answer is that there isn't that many opportunities for performances. But I think the bigger sort of question is around how people are viewing performances and this sort of this community versus professional discussion that I tend to have a lot, and I'm sure George has this as well in his work. What we always try to do is, advocate that as one of your other speakers has said, is that it's about the celebration of the artist and the actual art being celebrated as much, even more so than any kind of sympathy. It's kind of quite dated, and we would say perhaps like the use of the tragedy model of disability in the UK, and we tend to find that there are two kinds of performances. There are performances that are put on a community level, which is more about sympathy, and then perhaps this more professional way of looking at it, which is about the ability of the actual performance, which is what we're all talking today and which we're all advocates for. So I think that it's really, really key to differentiate between those two. That's not to say that community events can't be about ability, but that's tend to what I see. And I don't know if any of the other guys have encountered this, but we tend to notice that performances fall into two categories. It's either people really embracing that ability, or it's people that perhaps don't quite get the message and that are actually wanting to display a bit of sympathy.
Right. George, what do you think about that?
Yeah, thank you. I would agree with with everything that Anthony said, but also at the place of the deaf community in the UK. I know this from having worked in a theatre in Bristol, that the challenges seem to be systemic, that we need to check our culture, our way of working, to rethink it. We need to look at the way art is funded, because it can kind of create blocks to inclusive and accessible cultures. For example, if you ask a theatre how many British Sign Language interpreted shows do you have on in a season, they might be able to afford somewhere between 5 to 10, if you're lucky. You know, the question of like, why isn't every show, why doesn't every show integrate sign language? Why isn't there an opportunity for every night of that show for the deaf audience in that community to come and see it? Why do they have to pick just one date? And that comes down to funding. It definitely doesn't come down to bad will or lack of effort, but I think there are multiple issues. And then there's the, what I alluded to in my talk, the kind of personal aspect, which is because of, at least in the UK, there's a kind of an ignorance, historical ignorance that we're all complicit and part of. I think there's a lot of work that we need to do on, for example, a hearing community to educate. So the problems are kind of multifaceted, but there is a lot of hope for the future. Things are starting to change, and I think we're starting to change, and that's a great first step.
Great, thanks. Now, John, you have been creating your own show, and is it the reason behind, because like there might not be enough opportunities for everyone to present or to give opportunities to people of different backgrounds, so that you're creating your own shows and then you're presenting it like everywhere?
Yes, and I think something that I've been hearing today, what you both said, and George, you had talked about this mask of benevolence. Anyway, I really enjoyed the way you talked about that, because, and you expressed the way you also, you know, you saw yourself in your different levels of understanding this culture, and you realized how, oh my gosh, I used to be, you know, you learn, it's definitely, I think for everyone, you learn in these grades, and you realize how your former behavior, hopefully, has grown, or how you've grown to understand it better. And in this way, I think with my performances, what I found is that, right, I think almost everyone starts from what you were, what you others have referred to, right? It's just from almost just the point of view of sympathy and just that whole idea. But with these performances, I think I've found that it does, anything you can do to make people think, and just to get in that world that perhaps they don't have a lot of experience with, to get them thinking about that, and allows them, I think, to get into what I feel honored to be in, just a culture where I'm learning more and more about it. And I think once people do that, they can go from the, I guess you can say, the opening or the level one, where it comes from this sympathy, but also kind of an idea of superiority, to where they realize that, oh, it's not like that at all. And I think if you get that one shift, that they see it, that they, oh my gosh, they see themselves of how they had been looking at it, but then they see a new light. For me, that is where a lot of, I think, the hope, at least in changing a little bit of the culture of I guess you could say, most of us, towards the people with special abilities.
Thank you so much. 我想睇下 Mimi 你點樣睇頭先我哋講嘅一啲嗰啲問題。
其實我諗緊幾樣嘢，或者頭先一路聽各位講者分享咧，我都諗緊一個係大家雙向嘅嗰一個溝通。 無論是可能是個老師和學生的嗰個關係，又或者是藝術家和藝術家之間，我哋點樣去找到一個互為平等的一個關係，同埋呢個關係，我覺得是需要一個很長時間去建立的。即係例如剛才聽到 John 所講，佢同佢個學生有25年去建立呢一樣嘢，所以佢哋可以由呢個師生關係一路可以成為大家一齊partner 咁樣去一齊去做演出去創作。咁我覺得如果我哋一路講緊話，我哋點樣可以延續呢一樣嘢？我覺得呢一個身份咧，亦都好關乎我哋點樣去思考。大家究竟是處於什麼位置？究竟是不是我們經常覺得，我們去分享，我們去教一些東西出去，還是不是？剛才一直都提及過，我們是轉了個角度，發覺原來很多東西是我們的不足，我們自己的不認識，所以其實我們需要向一些不同身體能力的朋友去學習。但是我覺得可能有時候現在最初的起步，很多時候的難處是對於一些身體能力不同的朋友，他們自己未必會有這個想法，覺得他那些東西分享出來是讓我們學習的，他們經常都會覺得將自己放在可能一個所謂低位他去學習，而他不知道原來他是可以教回我們這麼多東西的。我覺得怎樣去處理這個思維是很需要時間，大家一路去再延續去整理
咯。馬 Sir 平時在學校是怎樣去處理這個思維的呢？
其實我剛才想回應Mimi的個關係咧，同埋阿 John 的經驗咧，即係我覺得同個同學仔你要同佢有個好的關係去到教佢啦，咁即係其實都唔容易嘅，即係你會睇下個小朋友佢個要佢培養到個興趣啦，咁即係我哋喺學校咧，因為學生其實唔多啦，咁我哋都會揀一啲佢哋覺得佢哋有個能力喺度啦，咁咧都會俾佢哋去到試啦，咁我哋真係要諗好多唔同嘅方法，同佢哋有個好嘅關係啦，溝通得好啦。咁啊，等佢咧去到有興趣去到學嗰樣嘢咯，即係有好多時可能佢哋會接觸到好多，咁但係佢哋又未必知道邊樣係啱自己咯。咁我哋即係作為老師啦，其實都會成日都見到啦，咁都要幫引導佢哋啦，去到揾到啱佢嘅嘢，培養到佢嘅興趣咧，咁佢會有個動機咯。咁即係我覺得其實佢哋有個動機去學啦，學到之後咧，喺個表演入面咧，我都係好重要啊！佢點樣可以 enjoy 佢個表演啦？佢唔係喺個低位嘅，即係佢係真係有個達到一個能力咧，俾人哋去認同咯。咁我自己即係個經驗就係膽粗粗啦，試下去同啲同學仔參加音樂節入面嘅獨奏比賽啦，係同全部都係普通嘅小學嘅同學一齊去比賽。咁我希望佢哋喺當中，佢哋睇到其實自己嘅能力唔會係最差嘅，佢哋嘅努力嗰個付出咧係得到認同嘅。即係就算佢哋好辛苦咁樣行到出去唔能夠企喺度去到演奏，但係咧佢哋都可以好勇敢將佢哋做到嘅嘢去到展示出嚟。咁跟住佢哋就可以靠著呢個經驗啦，有個信心去到繼續去到學落去咯。
咁我哋啱啱聽到，即係一個演奏者，佢最中意最緊要就係去建立佢嘅自信心，然之後佢就有能力去演出。咁喺呢度，我都想問一下 Anthony，I have a question for you. When you were working on the Buffalo Boy, how did you scout the dancer like, and how was he being staged as the solo dancer in the show?
That's a really good point to make straight after. I was actually going to jump in and say that I think what I'm sort of hearing from the two people who have just spoken, and what I'd like to add to it is it's about raising the voice of these people. Yes, it's obviously giving them experiences so they see things, take them to festivals and things like that. But as the two speakers this morning have highlighted that, trying to implement like a non-hierarchical approach, trying to bring those quiet voices need support in order to amplify those voices. So with George's case, he obviously had it, he was bringing his colleague along to actually to speak alongside him. In John's case, you know, the student very quickly became, you know, turned from small boy into co-collaborator to almost reversing the whole situation that John is learning from him. I myself am a co-director. I work with On Sok Nee, who's the director in Cambodia, who's a disabled female. It's so important to have the voices of the people that we're talking about central to this whole discussion, and to really sort of empower them in order to have the creative control and the creative direction. And I think creative leadership, you know, disabled leadership is a big thing in the UK at the moment, and I imagine it is perhaps in Hong Kong as well. To reiterate that point, that those voices need to be at the centre of everything and have the creative control. And then to answer the Buffalo Boy point, so Buffalo Boy is our piece with a non-verbal dancer, Tuan, who has cerebral palsy. That was a very painstaking, long process of interviews with a translator in order to hear his story and to use that as the centre point for the whole piece. So it was about, again, coming back to some of the themes of this morning, adaptability and taking time to hear that voice and put that voice at the centre of the creation. I think that is absolutely key. That's how we did it. And I imagine that's how the other guys did too.
And we have been talking about identifying people of different potential. So would anyone like to elaborate on that?
我想先回應一下 Anthony 頭先講嗰樣嘢，因為頭先都講緊即係有 efficacy 嘅嘢啦。另外，我成日都會諗一樣嘢，就係其實我哋講緊展覽藝術嘅時候，畢竟我哋都講得翻去最盡嗰樣嘢，就係其實我哋畢竟係講緊藝術嘅藝術呢一樣嘢，其實係最終嗰樣嘢。咁到底喺咩時候我哋講緊 efficacy？ 有咩時候我哋講緊藝術咧？咁好多時候我哋喺展覽藝術會入邊，我哋都會去研究一樣嘢，即係其實。我哋好多時候我哋可能好 simply 淨係睇緊individuals 或者 as 一個 group 佢哋有一啲藝術嘅一啲嘅天分，咁喺我哋嘅立場就係我哋希望能夠將呢個天分 nurture 佢哋，慢慢令佢成長。咁而同一時間其實我哋又講緊一樣嘢喎，我哋希望讓更多人去理解其實一班嘅我哋叫嘅 AWD 啦，我哋自己叫，即其實佢哋係有唔同嘅需要，同我哋只不過唔一樣。個需要可能就係簡單到我哋係戴眼鏡嘅，咁其實即係話我哋眼有需要要啲 support 啦。咁所以呢樣嘢我哋點樣去 provide 呢件事呢？我都想分享一樣嘢就係頭先阿 Josh 有講過啦，就係、是、哇，其實原來我哋要做一啲通達嘅服務，其實講緊其實都係有 funding 呢一樣嘢去做嘅。例如大家而家睇緊我哋有手語嘅翻譯啊，有好多嘢，其實都係需要一啲嘅即係資源嚟到 support 嘅。咁我哋就成日都會同唔同嘅機構去傾咯。咁我覺得其實成個社會係喺度進步緊嘅。例如我用翻香港做一個 sample 啦。香港以往咧其實連一個可以好啲嘅一個房間，即係例如喺 theatre 入邊可以俾一個房間嚟到做一個手語翻譯或者一啲即係翻譯嘅嘢都冇嘅。咁但係咧，慢慢呢幾年咧，其實喺政府嘅規劃入邊咧，佢哋如果喺起 theatre 嘅時候，佢哋會諗一啲唔同嘅設施，例如有 RAM 啦，例如會有一啲房係可以攞嚟做翻譯啊，甚至乎會有一啲字幕嘅機。咁即係其實你見到當我哋一路去推動做 efficacy 嘅時候，其實大家係睇到，而政府佢會去 support， 或者再大啲係其實大家都見到嗰樣嘢嘅。咁我覺得藝術其實就係咁簡單地，我哋唔好理其實係咪話係我哋有一啲唔同能力嘅人士嘅藝術，而係佢哋嘅藝術就係感染咗大家咯。我見到其實大家做嘅嘢其實都係一樣。
咁我哋啱啱講咗少少關於政府嘅資源問題啦。其實我都想知道喺唔同地區嘅地方，政府嘅資源其實多唔多，亦都足唔足夠嘅咧？In different regions around the world, how much is the government support? Like, is it supportive enough, or is there like more could be done?
Go carry on, John.
I just for my my knowledge of that the support is, I guess, enterprise as well as government. I would say it's still the government gives partway, but it's mostly the private sector, sometimes religious affiliations, temples or churches that help with it. And it's gotten, I think it's improved a lot. And I think it's improved to a level, at least it, here, that it seems that all the basic level of support is there, including not only education and on all different levels, but also just transportation and ease of communication, hotlines that for any time they can call and just certain needs will be met. And I think that's given, at least for the those with special abilities that I know, just has given them some sense of, comfort, right? Comfort that even if they don't need a lot of this stuff, if they do, they know it's there. And I think that is what a lot of this support does for them. There was talk about why isn't there, for example, sign language at every show. There's only for one of the many shows. And I think in some ways it's great that there is for every show, because it's just a reminder. And as well as those people with special abilities know that, oh, they don't have to go through all these special hoops just to get something basic. Do we have to call and see if it's wheelchair accessible? Kind of thing. So just the more you see it, the more you'll realize when it's not there, and it'll cause people to say, hey, maybe you should do something about that. And right, I think that's where it just becomes a very virtuous cycle.
And I think art can have a huge part to play in that, as you say. You know, we did a project recently with WaterAid Cambodia, and it was a tour around villages, and it was a theatre piece around not building toilets on the top of hills, because that is what builders and town planners were still doing, is they were still building toilets, public toilets with steps at the top of hills, and then they were wondering why nobody was able to use them. And so, you know, even though Epic Arts in Cambodia is predominantly art based, we're still having an impact on that kind of that discussion around the social model, basically, in the country.
Right.
I think as well there's something to be said about our role as allies and keeping vigilant. So if you look over the last few decades, you can see loads of improvement, but more recently in the UK, you can see threats to access and a kind of progressive movement. So for example, in the UK, you have something called Access to Work. It's a government policy and funding that provides, for example, interpreters or money to pay for interpreters. So a deaf artist has to apply to the government, and then they receive funding to pay for interpreters so that they can go to work, which is it's their human right to be able to communicate. But in the last decade, there have been huge problems accessing access to work funding. There have been cuts, there have been limitations on the amount of money that any one deaf person can receive. And this has caused huge amounts of stress, especially when the timing of those cuts or limitations on funding comes last minute, and suddenly a deaf person's in a position where they don't have money anymore to pay an interpreter that just worked for a week for them. It's really stressful to owe over £1,000 to an interpreter, you know. So I think there's loads of work to be done in that area. You know, the name of this conference is Sustainable Practices. You know, that kind of funding, these kind of policies, they need to be in place and need to stay in place. And we, as a society, need to protect them and keep an eye on them, because, you know, things change. Societies go through waves of being more progressive, less progressive. And I think sometimes there's a fantasy that everything's just getting better and better and better. But actually, I think it goes up and down. And it's on us to keep an eye on that, I think.
Hmm.
資源方面啦，咁其實學校咧 特殊學校咧，香港相對個資源都豐富嘅，咁啊因為都好多唔同嘅funding 去贊助啦，有全方位學習嘅津貼啦，咁其實每間學校加埋因為疫情啦，咁我哋累積咗都有唔少嘅錢可以去到用啦，咁啊所以反而我哋就係要去揾一啲合適嘅導師啦，去到教有肢體傷殘嘅同學咧就唔容易嘅嚇，因為即係有經驗嘅導師啦，可能都未必多嚇，咁可能好多時佢哋當然佢哋喺嗰個藝術嘅範疇，佢哋係專業嘅嚇，但係咧佢哋對於肢體傷殘嘅小朋友，佢哋要注意嘅或者教授嘅方法咧，可能都要一啲嘅時間去到摸索咯嚇，咁所以我哋就學校會面對啦，就係唔係冇錢啦，但係就係要揾一個合適嘅導師咯嚇，都有少少難度。
即係可以繼續延續馬 Sir 講緊嘅嗰樣嘢，對於喺自己嗰個藝術範疇認識嘅人，我覺得相當多嘅。但係真係能夠同唔同身體能力嘅朋友去 work 或者去教學咧，其實我覺得呢個部分喺香港嘅發展暫時係相對比較少嘅。即係喺我身邊，即係譬如我自己就係少數會做共融藝術嘅人，咁我係見大家對呢一樣嘢可能。仲係未係好認識，或者未見到佢嘅可能性。即係譬如在於我嚟講，我係覺得啊，如果我有機會同身體唔同能力嘅朋友去跳舞，在於我嚟講係一個寶庫嚟嘅，好多嘢可以發掘嘅。即係譬如我睇 Buffalo Boy， 我真係覺得哇，如果我好期待有機會我可以同佢一齊跳舞咧就好啦咁樣。咁但係好似一般嘅朋友，佢哋就會覺得佢哋未跳到舞喎，或者佢覺得佢哋唔認識喎。咁反過嚟就係、是。正正頭先講嗰樣嘢啦，究竟係邊個唔認識邊個咧？係咪我哋唔認識唔同嘅所謂唔同嘅需要，所以我哋變咗唔識教其實？咁我覺得呢一個發展，即係譬如喺智能藝術會，我過往都合作咗好一段日子，我哋都嘗試即係譬如我去教嘅時候，我係咪可以帶多啲助教，等佢哋喺有一個基礎，然後可以再延續咧？咁但我始終覺得對於本身。藝術工作者呢一個範疇嘅學習或者呢個教學嘅分享，暫時係未足夠嘅。我見到嘅係
係啊，因為例如好似我哋喺展能藝術會入邊咧，我哋係好努力咁樣，我哋希望可以邀請到更多嘅藝術家能夠參與教授啦，或者甚至乎係共同創作一啲嘅藝術作品嘅。咁但係我估好多嘅朋友咧，佢哋對於展能藝術啦，或者甚至乎對於同殘疾人士嘅相處咧，其實係有一啲嘅障礙。佢哋自己，我覺得最大嘅係自己嘅心理障礙。我成日都會同一啲藝術家傾嘅時候，佢哋會去覺得啊，其實我會唔會有陣時好會 hurt 到佢哋㗎？我到底知唔知道點樣去相處㗎？咁變咗呢樣嘢咧，都係一樣嘢係阻礙咗，即係其實我哋所講嘅即係個發展嘅。咁但係我覺得有一樣嘢都好重要嘅，就係其實最重要嘅就係藝術碰到藝術，即係大家互相去接觸到嘅話咧，其實因為藝術嘅創作而去衝破嗰一啲所謂嘅叫困難啦。咁我諗呢樣嘢係有可能嘅。咁同埋有一樣嘢，我覺得比較好嘅就係頭先我都提過，即係其實政府都多咗一啲嘅資源去支援，無論係講緊個別嘅藝術家或者一啲團體啦。咁希望其實咁樣慢慢可以即係培育到更多嘅一個群體，係去支援即係唔同能力嘅朋友去創作，或者甚至乎係共同創作咯。
在大家很踴躍地討論的時候，在個 chat box 都很多問題，我想將我們的時間縮短一點而去答多些大家在 chat box 上的問題，因為很多都很有趣的，例如 There's a question for Anthony. Anthony, the question to you is, can you share your feelings when your relationship with the dancer changed from a teacher to student relationship into co-worker? And the second question is, any of the epic artworks is featuring or integrating Cambodian classic art form or culture?
Sorry, could you repeat that question?
Yeah, it seems that there's like an internet, there's like internet issue, right? So let's see if this works. The first question to you is, how How do you feel between the relationship that you changed from a teacher-student relationship into a co-worker relationship when you work on the Buffalo Boy? And the second question is there any Cambodian classical art form or culture being integrated to your previous works or upcoming works?
Right. So the first very, very easy answer is I'm a non-disabled white English male. I'm not a disabled Cambodian male. So when we were devising the Buffalo Boy, he is the expert. It's not me. So the transition between George said earlier, you know, we use this term director, but it's always co-creator, and it starts as co-creator. And actually, in many respects, because Buffalo Boy is about Buffalo Boy and it's about Tuan's story, he is the expert, and he is the director, and he's in control. He doesn't have a voice, so we have to work very hard to make sure his voice is heard. So that's how I would answer that, really, is that it never really, I mean, as John said as well, we're learning all the time from the people we work with, and diversity is just such a wonderful thing, because I think the people working in it, for the most part, understand how rich their lives are made from working with these incredible people that do things, you know, perhaps slightly differently, but with such great richness, and I think that's really important. And then in terms of the Cambodian culture in any next performances, we've been drastically affected by COVID-19, and the last 2 years of Epic Arts has been can we sustain the organisation. So there hasn't been too much focus on artistic output. We are the main thing is Buffalo Boy was created just before the pandemic, so it's mainly Buffalo Boy we're focusing on. And there is another Epic Encounters have another piece which is called In Softer Skin, and that was created with a UK choreographer called James Cousins, which is a contemporary piece, and that doesn't really have much Cambodian culture in it. We tend to mix it up. We kind of tend to do something that perhaps is a little bit more cultural, and then something that's a little bit more, you know, contemporary in the sort of international sense.
Great, thanks. Now, there's another question in the chat box that asks about general perception of the general public. Is it been changing in the past few years in Taiwan and UK and Cambodia, as well as Hong Kong? Like, anyone would like to?
If I could just say one little thing, I've just seen in my 25 years being in this one spot and seeing audience reactions and talking to people after about the situation, I think there's been a lot of growth in Taiwan and understanding. 40 years ago in Taiwan, a blind person basically was almost, all of them became massage workers. They all were given glasses to wear and a white cane, and they were trained to give massages. And for up until I think only about 18 years ago, it was illegal for a sighted person to give a massage in Taiwan. And that had been a field that they had created for the blind in Taiwan. And actually that was a wonderful idea, and it did help a lot, especially back 30, 40, 50 years ago. But it created actually an interesting culture of blind people who then they wanted to do other things. Not everyone wants to do that. But it seemed that became the thing that they almost had to do. And for this reason, my student, for example, he doesn't like to wear dark glasses, because he thinks that's sighted people want you to do that. They did before, because then they'd know you're a masseuse. And anyway, so there was a problem with kind of identity within their culture. And also the idea that not everyone who is blind is, that's their only talent. So this changed about 20, 25 years ago. It started to, they changed the law. And actually, I think less blind people started to do that because blind people realized, the government allowed them to realize that they had a lot more opportunities in other areas. And so in this way, I think in Taiwan, people have seen now a lot of blind students and musicians are now working all over Taiwan as in all different areas as public performers in almost all the rest stops on the highway system, in the big cities at a lot of the shopping areas. There's a variety of performers, but you have special abilities. And so what I've seen, especially in the last 20, 25 years, is an amazing growth of their visibility. And I think that created just a more maturing of the society and their acceptance of people with special abilities. Thank you.
chat box 裏面咧都有條問題問到關於香港嘅狀況嘅，咁佢哋問到話喺香港嘅一啲藝術團體，如果要做共用藝術，有冇啲咩嘅條件係需要啊，或者有冇啲乜嘢嘅需求啊，同埋有冇啲咩嘅步驟係需要做，先可以將呢樣嘢去宣揚開去咧？
我估我先答啦，咁可能一陣間再其他幾位答。對於如果以我去諗法嘅話，其實對於任何嘅機構應該咁講，任何機構如果佢有興趣做共融藝術嘅話咧，其實我諗最重要嗰樣嘢就係其實即係佢哋有呢一個興趣去做，首先嘅 intention 係最重要嘅。咁第二樣就係其實點樣接觸到即係所謂共融嘅朋友啦。 咁共融嘅朋友其實可能係有機會可能去到我哋唔同嘅機構，例如頭先 Mimi 嘅機構啦，我嘅機構啦，或者甚至乎學校啦，可能同佢哋嘅接觸。咁當然啦，喺一個設施上面咧，可能都需要有一啲嘅協助嘅。咁即係例如係視障嘅朋友啊，例如聽障嘅朋友啊，甚至乎輪椅嘅朋友啊，咁可能設施上面都需要有一啲嘅一啲處理嘅。咁其實只係需要一啲叫做比較設施上面去處理啦。 咁你接觸到一啲唔同能力嘅人士啦，其實就夠噶啦。咁我覺得我好高興聽到有一個咁樣嘅問題，因為原來係有機構好想做嘅。咁我諗呢樣嘢最呢個樣嘢先係最重要。其實所有嘢其實都係一啲外在環境係可以解決得到嘅咯，或者揾我哋啊，係你哋啊。
咁我學校咧，我自己都有深刻嘅經歷啦。譬如同一個香港嘅一個管樂嘅都幾出名嘅團體啦。咁因為我哋同佢哋嘅指揮啊，係好相熟嘅朋友啦。咁我哋即係其實真係坐低大家傾下偈，佢覺得係可以試嘅。咁佢就邀請我哋去參加佢哋嘅一啲嘅music camp 啦。 咁喺入面就都睇返同學仔佢哋究竟嘅能力去到邊一度啦，可以參與到幾多啦。咁跟住經過幾次嘅排練啦，我哋就參加咗佢哋嘅一個annual concert 啦。咁我覺得即係都係俾同學仔一個好好嘅經驗囉。咁而我哋自己學校 舉辦嘅音樂會咧，其實我哋都邀請咗啲友好嘅團體啦，佢哋都嚟啦。咁其實除咗練習之外咧，咁我哋都彼此去到認識啦。咁我哋都會想介紹翻，其實究竟殘疾嘅小朋友其實係點嘅咧？其實好多係初初係唔認識㗎。咁但係到經過幾次嘅排練同埋一個嘅演出之後咧，其實大家嗰個關係啦係唔同咗啦。而對於普通嘅嗰啲嘅樂手咧，佢哋都係
即係一個好好嘅印象，其實音樂真係一個共通嘅語言咯。唔理你係殘疾啦，定係一個普通嘅人啦，大家一齊坐埋就係就嗰首歌係啦，呢個好嘅經驗。咁喺我嗰方面咧，其實我諗場地係一個比較會需要考量多啲啦，即係因為本身跳舞我哋就係需要多一啲嘅空間。咁尤其是譬如如果我哋涉及去到有輪椅嘅朋友啊，咁我哋需要嘅空間就更加要比平時可能更加大一啲。咁當然啦，所有嘅accessibility 嘅一啲配套嗰啲都係我哋好重視需要有嘅嘢啦。 咁我覺得除咗頭先即係硬件呢一個部分咧，另外就係翻去都係去翻我哋點樣去睇我哋大家嘅所謂嗰個差異啊。我想提翻一樣嘢就係其實咧，我哋譬如在座甚至我哋身處唔同地方嘅每一位朋友，其實我哋都係有身體差異嘅，我哋每個人都係唔同嘅。好多時大家咧一聽到做共融藝術或者身體唔同嘅朋友，就將嗰件事似乎反而係放得太大啊！佢坐輪椅㗎，啊佢聽唔到㗎，啊佢睇唔到㗎，好似嗰件事咧就係好大件事，所以就要做好多額外嘅嘢，或者甚至我就係聽一啲教學上面的朋友分享都覺得啊，咦，咁我咪要多好多耐性去調整我嘅教學或者做多啲嘢咯。咁但係即係在於我嚟講，其實嗰個教學去調整每一個學生嘅差異，其實我對任何學生都係應該抱有同樣嘅態度。咁所以我就係面對我見到嘅人，佢係點嘅咧？佢需要啲乜嘢嘅咧？或者點樣嘅學習係俾到佢一個最好嘅經驗，最能夠發揮到佢嘅咧？咁咪就係試咯。你其實就係人同人之間一個最真誠嘅溝通。咁我覺得呢一個心態反而可能係最重要嘅一樣嘢咯。
喺觀眾嘅問題裏邊有一個問題問 Mimi 嘅，佢問你：你覺得 train the trainers 係咪最有效可持續發展嘅方向咧？而之前又有另一個問題就係問你覺得點樣可以培育多更加多嘅人可以去培育唔同背景嘅人士咧？咁，
我諗係淨係 train 咧，未必係一個最好嘅方法。其實在於我嚟講，我覺得咧第一身嘅參與咧，反而係在於我嚟講，我比較覺得重要嘅。即係譬如就係如果有一個活動，你就用一個參加者嘅身份，你先去體驗。因為我覺得呢個體驗學到嘅嘢咧，遠遠係超過你覺得一開始就係、我嚟培訓導師。因為譬如我去諗翻我自己未去讀一啲咁樣嘅相關課程之前，其中一個比較深刻嘅體驗就係有一次我去參加另一個機構嘅活動，咁當時咧就係有一位坐輪椅嘅朋友，嗰位輪椅朋友係坐電動輪椅嘅，佢係用隻腳咧去控制佢嗰個控制杆嘅，咁佢咁樣嘅情況，佢嘅腳咧係最靈活嘅，咁所以我同佢埋去互動跳舞嘅時候，可能第一個反應我哋習慣跳舞就係、可能你手嘅動作啦，你會用個手去接觸同佢示意跳舞，但係好明顯呢件事佢即刻幫我打破咗嗰樣嘢，唔係喎，佢係用腳去溝通嘅喎，無論係可能佢改變咗我用個腳去同佢溝通，或者我唔再係覺得企喺度係最舒服，因為我都覺得我同佢唔係一個最好嘅溝通方式，所以可能坐低地下又好，我用唔同嘅互動方式，呢一個咁深刻嘅體驗咧，其實唔係我去學一個導師課程學翻嚟嘅，反而就係我喺一個參加活動，做一個參加者嘅角度而體驗。咁我覺得呢一啲嘅深刻，佢會好幫到。如果我繼續有興趣，我想去教課，我想去了解更多，呢一啲體驗反而係更加實在同埋更加深刻嘅咯。
I think it somehow refers to something that John has told us in his part earlier on, talking about a different language to describe sound. Especially when you're teaching piano, normally when we talk about sound, let's say we talk about a chord, like C major chord, you were playing D minor chord and G major chord. Itself, it's a like weird chord progression to begin with, right? Normally you don't do those kinds of chord progression. And when you mentioned sound in a different way, what is the main idea that you had or the main tool that you were using when you were trying to describe sound to a different ability?
I think what I was talking about there was about exploring a language for us both to talk about sound. This also goes along with one of the things in our first show. We had one section in where he plays the sati, this gymnopathy, and he asked me, the first thing he asked me is, teacher, what is color? And anyway, we made this segment because he and I, anyway, we had these long discussions about what color is to a blind person. Of course, we know what color is, except try to explain that to a colorblind person. You don't see everything the same as everyone else. And so we all know this about a different person's eye. But it doesn't mean that The blind don't have a feeling about color. So through our discussions about this, I realized his ideas about color are interesting. The one thing, red, his response was, what about red? He's like, oh, red is sweet. And I thought, is this some kind of synesthesia? You know, how are his senses going on? And he said, well, no, because apples are red and apples are sweet. So for him, red is sweet. And so his associations, his connections about these colors were so interesting. And that's how we got into the talks about colors and then about sound. So as opposed to sound just being pitch, can sound be bitter? Can sound be sweet? How about salty? And he also has these kind of feelings that we usually put in this idea of someone who's synesthesia, who's a very has almost a different way in his brain of chemistry. But his are through his experiences. And so learning through that, I learned more about the way he, if I want to teach him about how to look at a sound, I can't always use just my usual terminology and language. But listening to him, I realized, it changed my terminology, actually with even my sight experience, but also at least changed my terminology with him.
Right. I would also like to ask George, especially because you combine different languages in one play. You have sign languages and you have spoken language. So how do you see the communication between different languages?
That's a really good question. I think one of the big challenges in the production was not allowing English to dominate the stage, because we wanted it to be led by the British Sign Language. And originally, when we first set out, there was this kind of fantasy, this is going to be a completely accessible production for everyone. But of course, it was almost impossible because you just can't do that. And when we tried, we failed, and we tested out different ways of working in front of audiences as we were making the show. It took us about 5 years to make it, and not all in one go, staggered kind of periods of rehearsal, time to digest. And in one of those tests, we had caption, spoken English, and BSL, and the deaf audience fed back to us that they found it really hard. They're very distracted by the English captions, and all they wanted was the BSL and a few very specific names, ages, things like that in English to support finger spelling in BSL. And so it was a huge learning curve for us. We had to make a choice, and then we had to think, once the show was up on its feet, how do we then make that show accessible for other people and add in other forms of access? The bilingual nature of the production was a really challenging thing to find and to get the balance right, or to actually imbalance it properly. And also just thinking about sound, it occurred to me listening to John, we also had to work really hard to find a sonic language for the show, because actually our deaf collaborators felt very strongly that we shouldn't deny the hearing audience of music and of soundtrack. But the hearing members of the team felt very passionate that it should be inclusive. And we ended up working with sub-bass woofers. You don't get that from the film, but when you're in the theatre, everything shakes and vibrates. And the sound designer and composer, Sam Halmarek, built this bass element to the entire soundtrack. You feel it all the way through. So a deaf audience were feeling the sound, while a hearing audience were, although they were feeling it too, they're predominantly using their ears, as it were, to hear the soundtrack. And that was a really difficult but fascinating process, and it led to an outcome that was quite surprising.
I guess we have a time for the final question for everyone is, why do you think theater and drama has the ability to achieve the goal of inclusion? Or music?
We've all answered that in the last 20 minutes. We've all talked about, how it transcends language, how it transcends, you know, sight and hearing. And, you know, we've talked about vibration and we've talked about, you know, I love John's salty piano. Like, and that's it. I think we're, you know, art has the ability to transcend. And I think that is in a way that other things don't. And I think that's probably the key.
I would add that art is one of the most satisfying avenues you could pursue with them. There's all different kinds of education, but art, what does art do? Art is for the spirit, the soul. The art is for your psychology. And I think art is a release. Art can create stress, but I think only it's in the art of creation, and that stress is an amazing motivation, right? And so I think in this way, it's also non-threatening. It's not going to about, well, I'm sorry, I was almost gonna say it, not about funding, but actually that's totally wrong. Much of it is about funding, but while you're doing it, while you're in the act of creation, you're not worried about that. And it kind of, it transcends you from some of the reality of, you know, basic school and learning and passing tests or just doing your shopping and that kind of thing. So I think that's where art it is definitely, it transcends a lot of the other, to me, which is more the mundane, but also I understand essential aspects.
I think that human beings naturally, sadly, fear otherness and difference. And what's so special about art is it creates a human encounter and human connection as well between you and anyone else that you happen to meet with. And that's the most beautiful thing, is seeing the humanity in other people. I think that's what art does. That's what's so powerful about it. And all of those fears and that those concepts of difference drop away when art succeeds.
我諗啦，即係對於我嚟講，藝術其實真係人嘅所有智慧嘅一個結晶。咁其實喺藝術入邊，亦都係一個最容易溝通嘅一個媒介。即係可能有陣時我哋需要，即係如果我哋用 language 嘅話，如果唔同嘅 language， 可能有陣時我哋溝通唔到。但係藝術所發出嚟嘅能量，其實係大家都能夠感受得到嘅。咁所以即係頭先講話，即係呢個題目點解佢會最好，就係本身佢真係最好咯。
我覺得咧，喺特殊學校嘅小朋友咧，佢哋嘅生活真係好枯燥。即係我覺得藝術俾到佢哋咧嚇，有可以睇多啲唔同嘅嘢啦。即係我覺得無論喺台上或者喺台下咧，我覺得都可以同普通嘅人打成一片。即係呢一樣係好重要，即係令生活即係老土啲講就多啲色彩。但係呢個係真嘅，我覺得。
咁我覺得其實藝術就係一樣翻去自己嗰度。咁既然我哋存在喺呢一個地球上邊，每一個人都有你嘅身體，你就自然可以翻去感受自己，然後無論你透過邊一種嘅藝術媒體，你就係可以去同人溝通、同人互動。咁我覺得呢個就係藝術發揮到出嚟即係最靚、最又都翻轉係最實在嘅一樣嘢。
Thank you everyone today for such a fruitful conversation. 今日嘅討論咧，好快就進入尾聲啦。咁感謝六位傑出嘅講者為我哋帶嚟嘅啟發啦，亦都感謝大家熱烈嘅參與同埋討論，多謝曬。接住落嚟咧，我哋將會將時間咧去交翻俾我哋嘅藝術節行政總監何家坤女士做一個活動嘅總結。
多謝曬 ，Sid， 好期待你個婆婆。不過大家咧喺我哋等到九月先至有得睇啊！我哋頭先講到有啲嘢係需時嘅，值得等嘅。咁第一樣嘢就係多謝你啦，今日嘅貢獻，同埋我哋咁多位專家嘅討論，同埋每一位今日參加呢個圓桌會議嘅朋友，多謝曬你哋。記住咧， 就 download 嗰個 QR code， 有啲乜嘢意見話翻俾我哋聽，等我哋可以參考，希望越做越好，越做有得進步嘅地方。咁仲有好多好節目睇嘅，呢、這個無限量嘅系列未完嘅，一路繼續有得做嘅。咁遲啲再見，拜拜拜拜，多謝曬。